In Acts chapter 12, we read that Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem back to Antioch. Remember that the church in Antioch had entrusted Barnabas and Saul with the responsibility of bringing a sizable offering of money to the church in Jerusalem. This offering was in anticipation of a prophesied famine, which in fact occurred about a year later. By the grace of God and through the exercise of the spiritual gift of prophecy, the church in Jerusalem had been supernaturally provided for beforehand. Now, Barnabas and Saul's work in Jerusalem was finished, and so they returned to continue their ministry in Antioch. They brought with them back to Antioch a certain disciple named John Mark. John was his Hebrew name, and Mark was his Roman name. This was common for many Jews to have both a Hebrew and a Roman or Greek name. Scripture informs us in Colossians chapter 4, verse 10, that Mark was the relative of Barnabas. Paul had highly recommended Mark to the church in Colossae. This is the same John Mark that we see in Acts 12, whose mother was a prominent Christian woman in Jerusalem. Remember that Mark's mother had been hosting a prayer meeting in her home, praying for Peter's release from prison. Their home was most likely a large home. It was big enough to accommodate a large prayer meeting, and they had a servant, so Mark's family was probably very wealthy. Mark's family home was also probably one of the regular meeting places for the church in Jerusalem, because it was the first place that Peter went to immediately after his supernatural release from prison. John Mark is also traditionally identified as the author of the Gospel of Mark, and he's often associated with Peter's ministry. Peter refers to Mark as "my son Mark" in 1 Peter 5, verse 13, which may indicate that Peter had personally led Mark to faith in Christ. History also attributes John Mark with having founded the church in Alexandria, Egypt. We read that there were certain prophets in the church in Antioch. Barnabas is listed first in this group of Christian prophets, and so it's probably likely that he was the leader of this group. Clearly, at this point, Barnabas is seen as the primary leader, with Saul in a supportive role. Later, these roles will change, with Saul, who becomes the Apostle Paul, assuming a primary leadership role. In addition to Barnabas and Saul, we read of three other prophets in the Antioch church: Simeon, also called Niger, which means black, Lucius of Cyrene, whose name means white, and Menean, who had been brought up with Herod Antipas, the tetrarch. As a former associate of Herod Antipas, Menean would have most likely been a person of prominence and influence. His name means comforter, which, interestingly, is one of the names for the Holy Spirit. And it's also one of the purposes of New Testament prophecy listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. It's also interesting that one of the prophet's names means black, while the other prophet's name means white. This is really a common trait of prophets. Prophetic people tend to see things in black and white. In other words, very definite and clear-cut. The scriptures tell us that these five prophets were fasting and ministering unto the Lord. This is an interesting phrase, ministering to the Lord. We often tend to think of ministry primarily as horizontal ministry, that is, ministering to the needs of others. But here we read that these prophets were ministering to the Lord. This tells us that Christian ministry is first and foremost a ministry to God. This is our first priority. Remember that the first commandment is to love God with all of one's heart, soul, mind, and strength. This is really the heart and essence of spiritual ministry. Ministry, therefore, is to be offered as spiritual worship. Spiritual worship is a ministry unto God. The word for ministry here is liturgio, from which we get the English word liturgy. This biblical word for liturgy simply means order of worship. The New Testament doesn't legislate any particular form or order of Christian liturgy. We're simply instructed in 1 Corinthians 14 to conduct Christian public worship services decently and in order. The real heart of Christian liturgy, then, is not that of a manneristic structure, but rather a vibrant, dynamic, real spiritual worship that is vertically directed to God Himself. Worship, whether it's private or public, is to be spiritual, powerful, and life-changing. We read that it was in this context of dynamic spiritual ministry unto God that the Holy Spirit spoke to this prophetic group and designated Barnabas and Saul to be set apart or consecrated for the special apostolic ministry that He had called them to. The church leadership in Antioch, after having further fasted and prayed, laid hands on Barnabas and Saul and commissioned them for this unique work, and then sent them out. We see several things from this. First, spiritual ministry is first and foremost a vertical ministry of worship. Secondly, ministry is God's idea, not ours. The Bible states that man makes his plans, but God ordains his steps. The early church was a prophetic church. That is, they weren't simply seeking man-led strategies based on good ideas. They were seeking and expecting to be led prophetically by the Spirit of God into God's specific and strategic purposes. Paul writes in Ephesians 2, verse 10, that believers are God's workmanship, created in Jesus Christ unto good works, which God has specifically prepared for us beforehand that we should walk in. This means that God has plans and purposes for each one of His spiritual children to walk in. As children of God, through faith in Jesus Christ, we need to pray and seek to be led not according to our own ideas or desires, but according to God's will and God's desires. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. John writes in the book of Revelation that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. If we are to fulfill God's purposes in our own generation, just as the first century Christians did in theirs, then we too must be a spirit-filled, spirit-led church. Let's consecrate ourselves fully to seek God's specific purposes for our own generation. Let's expect the Holy Spirit to supernaturally direct and intervene in our own lives.